we're here today striving for excellence with our guest, Frank Leboeuf. And Frank was a World Cup winner in 1998 for France and was also a former Chelsea Football Club captain. So welcome to Jakarta, Frank.
Thank you.
Have you actually been in Jakarta before?
Yes, my third time here, in fact. The first time was straight after my career, the chance to play in a movie in Bali.
Wow.
It was a comedy, and we had a fantastic 15 days, you know, shooting in the middle of Bali, and it was absolutely fantastic. And then I came last year to play a game in Bandung against Príncipe, and it was a great game. We enjoyed the passion of it, and yeah, I feel great. It's like home here.
But just winding back, that you're coming towards the end of your career after football, and you've gone into acting. But how did this all start with your childhood? How did you have a thought of becoming a footballer from an early age, or by chance, or what happened?
Well, I was born and raised in a small village in south of France, and naturally, because my father loved football, it put my two brothers and I into that sport, and it became a passion, in fact, you know. It wasn't any days where we didn't kick the ball and enjoyed, you know, the confrontations between my brother and I, but also my schoolmates, and every time after school we were kicking the ball, and then we had training session on Wednesday, games on Saturdays. We are belonging to the club of the village, and it was only natural to kick the ball. It became an idea of professionalism not before 14 years old, and before it was just being passionate about that sport and just willing to enjoy the time with my friends.
But were you a natural footballer, or did you really have to work hard at it to become proficient?
I never thought that I was talented, that I saw many other players more talented than I, but I think I believed in myself, and I believed that I could go very far if I wanted to. It's never been easy. I've never been born and raised. I've never been raised in a very wealthy family, and so it was hard for my father. And we had to work hard at school, and we had to run hard and work hard on the pitch. And so when I decided to become a professional player, I knew that I needed something special, because I wasn't as talented as the others, and that I needed to work hard and use my heart, but also use my brain to find a way for me to be successful.
Can you remember when you decided yourself that you knew that you could become and wanted to become a professional footballer?
I think it started around the 1978 World Cup, when I saw France going to the World Cup for the first time during my life, and all my heroes going there, my idols, and also discover Mario Kempes and Passarella, big Argentinian stars at the time, and I said, wow, I saw all the papers coming down from the stands, and I said, well, that would be fantastic to live that kind of life. And but the structure weren't what we have now, so it was more difficult to be recognized, especially when you were coming from a small team in a small village. Mm-hmm. But it came up, you know, doing trials for academies,
right,
and being picked. It didn't work out very well, so it didn't keep me for like 2 years. But it was such a passion that I was ready to carry on and work hard, even harder. And then I found a professional club, did another trial, and a month after I was playing in the league. Huh?
Were your parents supportive? I mean, normally no parents. I've got two kids who growing up, and there's always this issue with the parents, well, look, you want to play football, but what about your education? I mean, how did you handle that?
My father was really behind us, and especially behind me when he felt that I was maybe the one who wanted the most to be the football player. My mother, not really. She wanted me to study first, to think about maybe a normal career. And now she's happy because I'm an actor and she loves acting, and I was going to I was watching TV with her and seeing plays with her. But yeah, it was lots of controversy between my parents about me embracing the football career.
So were there any sacrifices that you had to make or your parents made for using
my parents,
your passion?
No, my parents, no. They let me do what I wanted to do. It's true that to stop my my studies just before my degree. And unfortunately, as I said before, it didn't work out very well. So I ended up having nothing. So at that time I was 17 or 18. And I say, well, now I have nothing. And I have to take full responsibility for what I've decided to do. So now I have to carry on and pursue the way of happiness. And so I did everything, like not going out at 18. Never.
Never.
Just realized that. I didn't have any normal childhood, because I was focused on what I wanted to do. And if you want to be special, because you have to be special when you're going to be a football professional player, you have to do sacrifices. So what you eat, what you drink, how you sleep, it's all about football. You have to live, dream. I mean, the commercial we saw around the world was completely true. You dream, you sleep, you live football, otherwise you will never be a football player.
Just take me through very quickly, how do you actually get into the national team?
Well, I signed for a small club in Laval, then I signed for another club in Strasbourg. And so many French players were talented already in the national team that I thought that there was no room for me. But I had the opportunity of giving some interviews to newspapers, and I said to friends and to people who were ready to listen to me that I was ready to be in Russia. Well, again, you have to take responsibility for what you say, and I work even harder to make sure that I deserve to be in the national team, and that the coach was right to pick me up. And it came, I started with the B team of the French national team, and it worked so well with my club that I seduced the coach, and he picked me, and he was the best hero of the French Federation, because he started in 94,
yeah,
straight after the disaster of not being qualified for the 94 World Cup. And we reached the semi-final of the 96 European Championship in England, and then we won the World Cup, the European Championship, and the Confederation Cup in 2001. So we won everything in 3 years. Fantastic.
You've lived the dream. I mean, you've gone all the way, and you actually were in the team when they won the World Cup in 1998. I mean, at that time, did you really realise what you'd done? I mean, in terms of not only your career, but what it meant for France as a country?
No, because you live your life as a football player, and again, you don't enjoy the what people see. You are one of the actors. You're here to perform. You're not here to enjoy. Well, you enjoy because you have the result, and you're proud of what you've done. You know you do something great,
yeah.
And you know that you are so fortunate to live this life. But you don't have the time to look, you know, behind and on your back what you've done. You have to go forward because the club, the national team, they ask you for results. So you're a competitor, you move forward. It's only at the end of your career you say, okay, let's see what I've done. Wow, that's not too bad. I can be proud of myself. But during your career, if you say, okay, I won the championship, or I won, I don't know, a cup, and it's enough that I'm going to stop and see what I've done and how good it is, you would never win anything anymore. So you are, in your mind, a competitor. You are when you are, you belong to the youth team. I remember crying when I was losing, when I was a child. I couldn't stand. I was a very bad loser. I couldn't stand losing a game, and for me it was the shame of the shame. And when I became a defender, because I was playing as a midfielder, for me it was a real shame, like the samurais, you know, in Japan, when somebody was taking me on. I couldn't stand that. I think that's the thing. You want to reach the top. I mean, if you don't want to be at the top, you will end up the last.
Was there anybody that stood out in your life, like a mentor, that you thought, wow, this guy's actually, you know, changed my life and, you know, helped you along the way?
When I was younger, no, I would have loved that, you know, but I was on my own. But after, the man who changed my life is Rui Gullit. I was belonging to the national team. I was working for a decent team, Strasbourg, but I didn't win anything. And I was already 28. And Chelsea came, with Billy called me and said, I want you. I was firstly very honored, because when Rui Gullit calls you, one of the best players in the world, it's good. And secondly, the challenge was very interesting. Other players were coming, like Mark Hughes, Viali, after that Di Matteo, Zola, Petrescu. That was a team, you know, to be in, because you could feel that we were about to start something fantastic. And Chelsea changed my life, really changed my life. It's why I'm faithful. I never wanted to play for another club in England, because of respecting what Chelsea gave me. And of course I'm an actor now, but if there is one club who can make me change my way of thinking, my life is Chelsea. If Chelsea offers me something, I will go straight away.
Really?
Yeah.
What are you striving for now? You've won the World Cup.
Yeah.
You're telling me about you're into acting. I mean, is that your passion now that you...
It is. It's been a passion since the beginning of my life. I wanted to be an actor, but I went into football because it became natural. Yeah. And I couldn't follow courses in my village. It didn't exist. And I never wondered until, you know, going to Chelsea, and being successful, seeing actors around me, and it came back to me, say, okay. And in 2001 I had the chance to be in a movie playing for Chelsea and going to Berlin to shoot in a movie with Harvey Keitel and many good actors, and I said, well, it's what I want to do after that, after football. But it's hard when you want to give up and you say, okay, what I'm going to do after. It's a fantastic life being a football player. Mm. We are so fortunate. Of course, you are known. You win trophies. You play football. It's a game at the end of the day. And on top of it, they give you money. So it's a fantasy life. And when you go back to the real life, it's another story. But it's also interesting because you know better about yourself.
So you've got your passion is acting. Interesting, you mentioned Chelsea, because Chelsea play in the most popular league in the world. You know, it's huge in Asia. A lot of the fans follow it. I mean, what was the difference that you saw between where you were playing in France on the continental style and the culture there, and the fact that when you went across to London and you were mixing with the British players, was there a culture shock? Or they took to you straight away? Or
at the end of the day, football is universal, so it doesn't really change. But because you have a new culture, we fought a lot in the history between England and France, and but I realized when I went to England that British also people were warriors. Mm. And the football is really the football they want us to watch. Mm. Is really the mentality they have, you know, going forward, going fast.
Yeah.
And that was very interesting. And it's true, it was a shock because you're not used to that. We play a slower football in France, and there is a total football when everybody enjoys, but it's also war. Mm. And you have to win, but you have the respect of the fans. I mean, it's a religion.
Yeah,
it's an entertainment in France. It's a religion in England. And I never thought that the Premier League was as big as it is. When we won the FA Cup, we went to Asia. We went to Thailand, Hong Kong, and Brunei. But I thought it would be more like tourism. And we arrived in Bangkok like rock stars, with mm. bodyguards, 5,000 people at the airport. And I say, wow, in fact, the Premier League is huge. And I went into researches about, you know, the rights and everything. Mm. And it's really amazing what they achieved in what for me was like 5 years, yeah. 4 years, now 22 years.
Why do you think that is? I mean, you've got La Liga, Serie A, Bundesliga, the French League. I mean, why is it, and what is it that the English Premier League has done to make it such a popular league
when it
attracts so much money?
And when I first came, you know, it wasn't the fashion. The fashion was to go to Italy or to Spain.
Yeah.
And I wanted to go to England because first I wanted to speak English. And you realize that the chance they have, they all speak English. And if you want to be in the business industry, but also nowadays in the sport industry, you have to speak English. In Asia, everybody speaks English. And that's a priority. And on top of it, I think people in England, deciders, realized that there was something fantastic to do in England, and they went into that business quicker than the others. They made a decision that they wanted the Premier League to be worldwide.
Right.
We just start now in France with Paris Saint-Germain, and they bought Beckham to get the Asian market. But it was like 2 years ago when England started 20 years before.
Yeah.
Italy didn't jump on that. They thought that it would natural that the press will come to them. Mm. Then when I think you have to do, everybody has to do their ways. And it's simply fantastic. It's very professional. They know exactly where they want to go. They made sure first that they attract the right players for that.
Yeah.
But also that they kept the spirit of the English football. I left Chelsea because Vialli took charge, then after Ranieri, and I didn't want to play as an Italian. I hate Italian football. Well, it's much better right now with Prandelli, the national team coach, and the football in Italy is getting a little bit more seducing. But at the time, it was really boring, especially for a defender.
Yeah.
And I like the spirit of the English. I like the way they go to stadium. No fences around. It's very friendly, and at the same time, you know, everybody cheers his team very, very hard. And when you're on the pitch, it's a war, because you know that people in the stand, they love you, and they will never insult you. They will but they will cheer you up like crazy, and if you lose they're gonna cry, and you have to pay respect to those people, and that's absolutely fantastic. I saw people in France insulting me, and you don't want to fight for somebody who insults you, but when you see somebody crying you say, oh my god, what a shame, and I want to be better because I don't want to see him crying again.
Yeah.
We just discussed earlier about the vision that the Indonesian Super League has here with the Utama League and the under-21s. And of course the Premier League in the UK has been going for, 22 years now. It's probably made all the mistakes it could, and they've learned from that, and the facilities have improved immensely. Mm-hmm. All the players are celebrities. Do you think that, you know, with a serious plan, that the Indonesian Super League here in this country could achieve something similar over the next 5 to 10 years?
Definitely. I think it's. I always compare with the Qatar, you know, who tries to do that with Aspire Academy and everything, but they have a problem of numbers. Here you don't have the problem. I'm pretty sure that you have Messi outside, Ronaldo,
somewhere.
Zidane, somewhere. Because you have 240 million people. Mm. And in France, we became champion of the world with 2 million people playing football. Here, it's crazy. The amount of people playing soccer, or football, sorry, is for sure a result of success if you really go into it and make sure that you go step by step. They have to start from scratch. The ISL started like 4 years ago, and they are babies right now, yeah. But they can be absolutely fantastic grown-ups if they carry on like that. But of course, they have to be surrounded by people who know football, who don't want to just get the money out of it, but want to achieve something. And I'm sure Indonesia will be successful because you have everything needed to be successful.
The league here is very well structured. Mm-hmm. The organisations there, and you know, a lot of the issues that they've had in the football industry in this part of the world have been sorted out. How important is it, do you think, the private support in terms of the commercial aspect of the game is to making this work, if they want to get somewhere in the next 5 or 10 years? I mean, you know, the league can only do so much. It needs support.
Oh yeah.
I mean, we've seen that in the UK and with the other leagues in Europe. Do you think the same model would apply?
Definitely, it's essential. You need support from private companies. You don't want any political aspects in the football, because already the FIFA doesn't accept that. It's forbidden to politics to go into the business of football. So being private allows you to really work as a company and do the best for the company. You have the sponsors, and we all know that nowadays money talks. When sure. We see Chelsea, yeah. We see Paris Saint-Germain, we see Man City, yeah. Barcelona as well with QSI. It's very, very important that you are structured to make sure that you're wealthy. And again, you're wealthy for something, to prepare the future. And the future are the kids. If you only think that you will have a good ISL without thinking of the future of your football, what's going to be the ISL within 10 years, if you don't think about that, you better stop now, because you're going to waste money. But if you do everything and you create academies, and you make sure you put money in it, like every clubs in Europe have done, and especially in England. I remember training at a very bad location nearby Heathrow. And now you see the Chelsea Football Club Academy with all the youth being really well organized, all the youth teams were very well organized. You see the changes. And, and if Chelsea is successful, and if other clubs like Liverpool, when you see Sterling, where that fantastic player comes from,
yeah.
Depict him when he was 10 years. He's 19 years old, he's already ready. Yeah. Because he has eaten football, he has slept football, he has dreamt about football, and he's not a fantastic player, but he's ready to be a fantastic player. Mm-hmm. And in Indonesia, I'm sure you have that kind of player. Mm-hmm. He's not strong, he's skillful, but he has his head and his brain, and he's been prepared like that. You have to prepare the future of Indonesia to become the best.
I mean, it's a crazy vision, but we were talking to some of the league executives the other day, and there was actually a mention of the fact that perhaps Indonesia could look forward to hosting the World Cup in 2030. And when you heard that, I was like, well, you're crazy, is that something that could actually happen, do you think, if given the plans in place and the whole nation gets behind it?
Well, listen, it's going to be within 15 years. So make some researches about 10-year-old boys, get like 500 of those, and start building the World Cup in 2030.
Yeah.
It's what Qatari tried to do for the 2022. Yeah. And it's really possible that Indonesia can be one of the best teams in the world. I mean, it's about probabilities and mathematics. If you are really professional, you make a circle of people who are ready to look for the right players and the spirit you want to get in Indonesia, or the kind of football you want to get, you're going to be successful. And that's for sure. It's impossible for me. It doesn't exist.
Well, exciting goal to aim for. Indonesia in the World Cup.
Well, Indonesia is one of the best country for badminton, and I've seen documentaries about young kids, you know, getting up at 7, sleeping, eating, dreaming about badminton. But football is the biggest country, the biggest sport in the world, and they can do the same, and they can be successful as they are for running.
I mean, from the point of view of our company, Three Lions Sport, I mean, the opportunity of actually perhaps being able to touch 150, 180 million people over the next 5 to 10 years is something that is definitely makes it very exciting as an opportunity. So
it is.
That's where we'd like to be.
Yeah, that would be fantastic. I mean, for me, if you just put one toe in it, and you have deciders, people who have, as you said, the league is already there, so they already made the first step.
Yeah.
Now they have to make sure they go the right way and the right path, and they want to go where, you know, the success is going to be at the end of the tunnel. And we are here for that. I mean, every players will be very happy to help any country. We want to be bigger, and it's possible. There is a way to do it. You have to make sure you do it properly. France, England didn't create the Premier League or the League One like that. We didn't become champion of the world like that. It took 4 years, but we were already professionals to get the 98 team. But it took like 5, 10, 15 years to build what we achieved in 98. So it takes time. People will have to be patient, but I'm sure they can do it, you know. Just do it.
Well, Frank, thank you very much for your time, and enjoy the chat. And you've got one thing to say, which is
strive for excellence.